Good. Hello. Nice to be here to the talk, Flamingo, Inspiring E-Commerce Frontend Made in Go. My name is Daniel Pötzinger. I'm a CTO at AOE. And in that role, I'm working with our teams to deliver software for our customers. Before I jump right into the topic about telling about Flamingo, why we did it and what it is, a few words about AOE. So AOE is a software development company. We are around since over 20 years, and we've gained a lot of experience in building and scaling enterprise web applications for our customers. What's special about AOE is we are a true agile organization with self-organized teams delivering the projects and a true agile mindset. We are around 250 people. Our headquarters in Wiesbaden, but we have offices around the world. We recently opened also an office in Frankfurt. I guess that's it about AOE, and I want to jump into the topic about Flamingo. So Flamingo, we call it our blazing fast commerce experience layer, and we open sourced it with Lav just about 2 days ago. So 2 days ago, we published it. The original idea was to already publish it 1 year back, but we always thought, like, no, we need to clean it up, we need to provide better documentation and an example project and so on, and things have been going. So it was good to have that date fixed here, the Code Commerce talk, because that was actually our milestone to really, really publish it. So we did so 2 days back, and we are very excited. So we are looking forward if others like it as much as we do. And in this talk, I want to cover what it is and why we open sourced it and why we even decided to build a framework in Go. So this is what I'm going to cover in the talk. Start with the question, what is Flamingo? What can it be used for? I'm showing what we did with it. So for example, we delivered the e-commerce platform for Heathrow Boutique. That is live now since over a year. We've recently won the Moody's Award with the Heathrow Boutique, and the Heathrow Boutique is a marketplace where you can shop on the airport from multiple retailers. There's a lot of logic in the background in this airport environment. You have to enter your flight, you have to check your flight. It's checked for which retailer you can reserve and collect stuff, etc. pp. So these are just some screenshots from the Heathrow Boutique. You can check it out yourself once you're flying through Heathrow. To mention another example, using just Flamingo as a web application framework, we've also delivered the My Account area for Auckland Airport. Another example, also for the Auckland Airport, this is also running the Flamingo frontend on top of a microservice-oriented architecture for their marketplace. So same but different. So also here you can shop from different retailers on the airport and even off the airport. Here you see, for example, more complex cart where you have multiple deliveries in the cart, multiple promotions added to it, multiple flights represented to the delivery, and things like this. So it's kind of not standard e-commerce. It's specific for marketplace and specific for airport in that kind. So this maybe gives you an idea what you can build with it. So the question is, did we really create our own e-commerce framework? So well, we not really, because it's not a complete e-commerce solution, absolutely. So it's more the front end that you can use to build commerce experience. The front end, it's more the head. We say it's the head for the headless e-commerce. So it's supposed to connect to different microservices that actually hold the logic. But still, there should be a lot available there. So why did we build a new framework? So, and the answer is yes and no. I mean, in fact, we did not start from scratch. We've used a lot of libraries that are major libraries and we consider as reliable open source libs. But to understand it, maybe you need to hear the complete story. So when we step back and look at the motivations that drove us before the decision. And when you look at some trends in e-commerce, you have some trends that are more coming from the business. So there's more and more requirements for personalization, more and more requirement to deliver targeted content to the customers that actually mean caching is in the way. So we need something that is really fast, that can deliver uncached, really targeted to the person that is just browsing the website. Second aspect is the e-commerce solutions and the e-commerce area is either you die and Amazon takes over or you differentiate. And to differentiate, you need to have features in it that are not standard. So trends are to do more collaborations with other retailers, to do more collaborations with partners, to integrate products into your shop, to build marketplace and things like this. So on the one hand, growing complexity, and on the other hand, the need for delivering really targeted content. That leads to like other e-commerce architectures that we have compared to what we have seen 5 years ago. So common e-commerce architectures are nowadays, you hear it a lot, microservice-oriented. Microservice-oriented architecture helps scaling in terms of teams working on it, but it also helps in terms of growing your product and developing new features. And the second trend, and this kind of related, especially in the e-commerce area, is the buzzword headless commerce. It actually also means you have services in the background, more service-oriented architecture that provide certain capabilities, and you build custom front ends for different channels to really go through omnichannel or to connect some of your services to partner systems. And there are a lot of solutions around, commerce tools, Contentful, Magento can be seen as, headless e-commerce for certain features and things like this. But what we are missing is a really stable and reliable way of how to build that heads for the different headless e-commerce. So when we quickly took that outlook about what are the trends, then we looked at how did we solve the challenges in the last year. So what did we observe? And I think same story but different. You all have this experience, I guess. So normally we started with using one of the big e-commerce shop systems that are out there. Problem with that, especially for the area where we are or where we are doing projects, they come with a lot of features. So there's so much insight, and a lot of that I don't need. So we have product management, full order management, fulfillment management, stock handling, payment, campaign management, even search and recommendation, holding the customer data and things like this. But big players have a lot of that already in the back end. They have an SAP system, Microsoft Dynamics, or anything else. Also, there are services that are actually doing better than what's in the package. So it kind of does not really fit. And for us and the requirements we have, it feels like unflexible and you are fixed to that box. Because there's so much in it, there's a high developer ramp-up time. So it takes a time until you understand it and can use it and adopt it to your needs that are maybe not pure standard. So it feels a bit like this. And then, last but not least, another thing we observed, maybe you observed too, once you put it live and have high traffic on that box, it's not working out so well. So we have to work with intensive caching, front-end caching, full-page caching, put a varnish in front of it, have indexing processes and things like this. If we have shops with millions or even 10,000s of products, that really can be a pain. So after rolling out many of these more monolithic shop systems and trying to work around with it, we find ourselves in that situation. So we spend a lot of time and money in building caching and performance features around and in the systems. We've building a lot of experts and imports to connect to other systems and synchronize data. It ends up in frustrated development teams, and we came to the conclusion that's not the way how we can scale, how we can deliver reliable e-commerce platforms for our customers. So the question is, can we do better? And the fundamental questions that we ask ourselves can be divided in two things. On the one hand, we ask ourselves, actually, if we would start from scratch or if we have a dream, How would you love to develop commerce platforms or even or more front-end commerce applications? And is PHP still the right development language for this, like it used to be? And to make it quick, the answers to these two aspects. So how would you love to develop commerce applications can be summarized in 7 points. Of course, performance is very important. We don't want to use cache to deliver a targeted and personalized content to the customer. We want to be able to deliver real-time, context-aware content to the customer. We want to have a clean architecture because we want to maintain the solution long-term. We don't want to throw it over and then nobody wants to touch it again. We need the flexibility that we need in a distributed environment with a microservice architecture. So we need the flexibility to connect to different systems easily. Also, we need no build and deploy overhead. We want to deliver it as a container together with the other microservices in Kubernetes, for example. Front-end is, of course, a very important part when you build front-ends, commerce experience applications. So we want as much flexibility there as possible because, as you know, especially in the front-end, new tools are around every half a year, so we don't want to couple it with the back-end. Want to have a certain flexibility there with a separate build pipeline. Testability is very important. The e-commerce solution normally consumes several APIs. If you want to properly develop and test it, you need to be able to test it in isolation without all the dependencies, and this should work out well. So testability is important. Developer experience at Hool is very important. The people working with the application and developing the application should have fun using it, and it should have a very low learning curve so that it's possible to get new people into the project. And last but not least, we wanted to have true open source, not a vendor lock-in, not something that is not really open source, but just open code or something like this. So open source was important. And the second question, is PHP still the right language for this? And I'm not going into any PHP bashing, but there are other languages around, and Basti explained it in the previous talk a bit more about what benefits Go bring. So I always like to explain it the way that Google invested a lot of actually supporting and developing a new programming language. And they didn't do this for fun. They did this because they need to scale. They need to scale in terms of team sizes. They had to have a lot of development teams. And all the teams need to develop good software, and they need to learn it quickly. They need to scale in terms of really runtime, so the stuff that is built by them should run in production, really performant. And they need to scale in terms of maintainability, so the software that the teams are writing, they should be maintained for a long time. So these are all aspects that got into the language, basically, and we can really confirm that the language really targets at this point. So some benefits, it's you don't need extra overhead, you don't need Apache or Nginx or whatever. It's all included, the web service kind of included through a library. It's compiled and type safe for the people coming from PHP. That is really refreshing and great to have a type-safe language. Half of the errors, I tell you, can be catched during compile time. It has true concurrency. Of course, that's what you need in nowadays world. It's very easy to learn. It's built to scale, as I just explained. It's supported by Google, so it's very unlikely that it's away tomorrow. And if you have followed the development, it got very increasing interest and success. So it's really jumping up. It's jumped up in the TIBO index of the programming languages that are used most frequently. So these two aspects, then we looked at, okay, what is around there? And actually, we didn't find anything that matches these two criteria. So back more than 2 years, end of 2016, we decided, okay, for the purpose for building modern e-commerce front ends. It seems like we need to build something new, but we definitely want to open source it. And I can tell you it was the extra effort that it took to open source it in a way that we think people can start looking at it and using it right away was a lot of effort that we put in and that the team put in it. So that as a motivation and a teaser. Sound would be great. Yeah, it's not working. Yes, it looks like this, exactly. No, in fact, I told this some guys in the front who said, okay, you took a very risky path of doing something in a new programming language. But the experience really shows that teams are within one sprint productive in writing Go code. So this is really what I can tell. We have now more than five teams that are switched completely from doing years-long PHP of doing Go with the Flamingo framework or just standalone Go microservices, and they don't want to switch back. So I think others could have the same experience. So some of the details about Flamingo Commerce. Flamingo, we say it's kind of under the brand Flamingo, we published several pieces. The three main pieces are Flamingo Core. This is the Go-based open source framework that you can use to build sophisticated web applications. We tend to say it's a micro framework because it comes really not with much overhead. It comes with what you need to build modern web applications. You can think of it like a Symfony 2, but just smaller and better and faster, I don't know, just in Go. And then you have we have Flamingo Commerce, which on top of Flamingo can be used to build commerce experience applications, and I go into some detail here. You can use certain modules of it, you don't have to. And the third package is Flamingo Carotene, which is our opinionated front-end build pipeline using PUC, SAS, and Webpack. That can be exchanged, but it's kind of working well together if you want to build the front ends rendered server side with atomic design patterns, and it's used, it's using popular build tools. So a bit more in detail, a typical enterprise web application, at least how we structure it, looks like this nowadays. So you have a front end application that always should consist about the front end that is running in the browser, so HTML, CSS, JavaScript in the browser, and you have the backend for front end that is running on the server side. And normal responsibility of the backend for front end is to act as a kind of anti-corruption layer for the tightly coupled front end. So it's preparing the data, it's preparing the logic in a way the front end requires it. It's having all the server-side logic that you don't want to put in the client, and there's always logic that you shouldn't put in the client. And last but not least, there's the need of not pushing everything to the client in a single-page application, for example. That's everything around data security, data privacy, so you have to keep things private. And this backend for frontend normally is the layer that connects to other backend services like a commerce tool or other microservices and takes care of using the resilience patterns that you should use when building distributed applications. It's also okay from the frontend to connect to some other Ajax capable APIs, but that is kind of showing the principal architecture. And for the frontend, or what you also can call the view or experience layer, it can follow any front-end architecture pattern. So it can be a multi-page application rendered completely in the back-end, can be single-page application, it can be extended with service workers to be a PVR. And with Flamingo, we kind of fulfill that in that way. So in the back-end for front-end, the Flamingo framework is running. On top of it, you can use certain Flamingo commerce modules. That should make your life easier when you want to build commerce front ends. And then, of course, your custom project code that is also in the backend for front end. And then you have the front end part where you can use Flamingo Carotene and follow the patterns there of defining templates in PUC and atomic design components also in PUC, and then compile the pages together with the data that you get from the backend for frontend. Some words about frontend architecture in general. I put that slide in because there are so much talks about component frameworks for building frontends with web components or React or with Vue or with Angular that are more tending to be a single page application. So I just want to give a view on that one because you have multiple ways of nowadays think of delivering your frontend. The classical approach is the multi-page application, meaning the server renders HTML and sends it to the browser. That is still, believe me, the king when you want to have the fastest possible render-ready time in the browser. Therefore, it's still the king for SEO. You can then use progressive enhancement to improve your page. I've not put other benefits of here in terms of maintainability and cost of building such an application. It's normally 30% cheaper than doing the same in a single page application. And especially for e-commerce, where you have a broad funnel, where you have a lot of users that are unique visitors to your site, that are arguments that still, in our opinion, make it necessary to have server-side rendering. Of course, with Next.js or others, we can also achieve this. It's more about thinking of server-side rendered HTML and deliver it as fast as possible to the browser. Then you can build certain you can build your page or just certain subpages of your page using the single page application approach. That is the way to go when you have high user interaction on your page. For checkouts, for example, that's a typical thing where you would do a more single page application like approach and don't want to reload the page after every checkout step. And you can use any of the frameworks there and then can further extend it with offline features. So my point here is that despite the hype that you have with PVR, I think for a long time we'll still need maintainable and proven solutions for delivering multi-page application, especially in an e-commerce environment where you have, I don't know, 10,000 or 1 million product single pages. Good, that's this. I wanted to put it on here. Another aspect for Flamingo Commerce that is important is clean architecture, as I said, and we are using two building blocks here. Domain-driven design, that's something we have always been into because that's the way of building maintainable software when the core problem area is in the business and not in the technology. And for our kind of projects and e-commerce project, the complexity that you need to solve is in the real world, so domain-driven design is your friend. And the layering approach, ports and adapters, I come to this in a minute. So Flamingo Commerce actually comes with somehow opinionated bounded context with its domain model. So this is what Flamingo Commerce is. So there is a product package that defines a product domain model for different product types. There's, for example, a search module that comes with domain models around providing search. There's a card package, one of the biggest packages there, that is representing a generic structure how a card could look like. It's built to be a multi-delivery card, so you're putting not items in the card directly, you're putting items under delivery, and you can have multiple deliveries in a card. That's very important for marketplaces and more complex checkout scenarios. Also supporting multi-payments, so each item can be paid with different payments, and the customer, in theory, can decide how to pay the grand total, maybe with loyalty points, and maybe with PayPal, and maybe with credit card, and things like this. So some of the modules, a lot of experience have been, from our projects, of course, have been provided and built in. So the idea is that each of the bounded contexts can be used. You don't have to use them. You can also build your own product package that represents the data structure that you have for your product, for example. The idea is that they are all easy to use and easy to understand, not coming with, again, less is more, not coming with overhead. They should be a so-called potent model in that area. And very important, the domain model should be technology neutral. So if you look at the product model, we can look later together, it's just holding the data and maybe some behavior on the data. There's nothing about database or microservice connection, nothing. So it's technology neutral. And But at the end, the product data need to come from somewhere. And there we use the layering approach, pods and adapters from the big, let's say, the software design gurus. It's even considered to be a potential timeless architecture. So it's a way that you can use to structure bigger applications to keep them maintainable. So there you clearly differentiate between the four layers, and you will find this in all Flamingo modules that contain some business logic. So starting from the inner, you have the technology-free domain model. That's what you look at it, you should like it, you should understand it, you know, okay, this is the models that I can use in that bounded context. Then there's a small application layer. That's kind of the entry point to the domain layer. It's having the application use cases in it. Then there's a third layer called interfaces that has everything in it that is specific to communicate with the outside. So if you provide a REST API or an Ajax API, and that should have another data structure, the data structure belongs in the interface layer, so-called data transfer objects. Also web controllers, the web is an interface. Formular handling is an interface. So that all belongs in the interface layer, and the domain layer should not be poisoned with that presentation logic. And last but not least, you have the infrastructure layer. This is where all the details live. This is where you take care of, okay, the product data should actually come from that microservice or should come from the Magento API or from the Commerce Tool API. And as with any layering approach, dependencies only allowed inwards. So the domain model doesn't know anything about application interface or infrastructure. And ports and adapters defines a concept of having primary and secondary port that allows the infrastructure layer to control where the product data and the domain model should come from. I've tried to make an example. So imagine the product bounded context, the product model in Flamingo Commerce. You'll find something like, okay, a product domain model, or more for different product type, it's simplified here. And there is a product service that you can use to get a product by ID, for example. It's defined in the domain model because it has a meaning in the domain. You need a product service as entry point to get a product, so that is part of the domain model. But it's not implemented there, just the interface is defined there. And then in ports and adapters, you define or you define or you have two different kind of ports. In this case, the product service acts as a primary and secondary port. Primary port is the classical one. So a layer above just uses the service and calls the service. In that example, you'll probably have a product controller in the not application layer, interface layer. That's wrong on the slide. Because that's interface logic. The color's right, but okay. So you have a product controller and the view action, and the view action needs to get the product, so it's using the product service from the domain layer to get the product, pass it to the view, and maybe transform it, render it, whatever. So that's fine. So primary ports are called from the outside. And secondary ports are actually implementations of this interface. So in the infrastructure layer, we have a so-called secondary adapter to the secondary port. So the domain layer say, okay, this interface is a secondary port. I need someone to implement it. I don't care how it is implemented. And you implement it in the infrastructure layer. For example, having a product service adapter, and there you implement what actually should happen when someone calls get me a product. There you can call a microservice, you can get it from a CSV, you can get it from a database if you like. So this is the idea of ports and adapters. And seeing this as a concept that we have for all the Flamingo Commerce modules, so the Flamingo Commerce modules actually come with a domain model, the application layer for it, and controllers that you can use. But it's not coming with an implementation of the secondary ports. That is up to the project, that is up to you, implementing the secondary ports. We have, and that's not open source yet, we have Magento adapters, for example, that are implementing the secondary ports in that layers and connecting to the REST API of Magento to get products, to get the card, to update the card, things like this. There can be a commerce tool adapter and anything else. So this is really the core concept. And what we have, just for demo reasons, is providing standalone adapters so that you can have a first impression of how to work with Flamingo Commerce, but don't need to connect to any service. So this This is provided, it's not production ready, just for demo purposes, so it reads product from a CSV file. It holds the card not in the card service, but in memory, things like this. And this is actually what you can try out. How many times do we have? And if you like, we can try it out together. You see that there is the commerce demo carotene we call, because it's demoing also Flamingo carotene templating. And you should be able, by just following these lines of code, you are cloning the repository. You can download some product test data. They are not in the repository, of course. And then you build the front end using NPM and Webpack. And then you just run the Go application. And that's what we can do here. So this is just a checked out repository. Make serve actually just runs. You see it here. Normal Go, run, main Go, and then the serve command of Flamingo. And then the Flamingo application, including Flamingo Commerce and the standalone adapters, are running. And you can open it and see the same that you see online, having some test products. Moment, some other test products here. You can add them to the card, proceed to a standard checkout, so you can try it out yourself. And then maybe I can also demo the demos in the live presentation, always perfect. So this is the standard bootstrap here from Flamingo, loading a lot of Flamingo framework modules or some that we need. Loading some of the Flamingo Commerce modules for products, for categories, for card, for customers. Then the adapters that are using, that are implementing the secondary ports and loading product data from CSV. And what I've prepared is to implement another implementation of the product service that I load here. So what I have is inside of the project just a new Flamingo module that is very straightforward. So actually it only has in the infrastructure layer an own implementation of the product service, implementing the get method to return a product. And in this case, it's just returning a very plain, simple product. That's just for demo purpose. And I activated that package here just by loading the package here. What actually happens if a package is loaded, then the module go from that package is evaluated. And in this case, I'm registering the fake product service as an implementation for the product service using the dependency injection container Dingo that belongs to Flamingo. And what I'm also going to do is that's it. I'm overriding it. So, and if I now restart the application, it's starting again, looking at the browser again, maybe going back to my product page, reloading the product page. I see, okay, the product is now always the faked simple product, and this just to show how easy it is to implement a secondary port. We use this to provide fake implementations in a test mode or a development mode, or easily provide certain test data with certain attributes. I wanted to show this quickly, and you can try it out yourself. Back to the slide. Good. As Basti also mentioned in the previous talk, we did not open source it just to open source it. We open sourced it with love, so we put really extra effort to provide demo, clean it up, provide documentation. Of course, it's not everything 100%, but we want that others really also can use it, and if they like using it, then really be productive with it. So we are planning to do a training with 40 seats at the end of the summer. If we got your interest and your interest to learn more and have some hands-on on Flamingo and Flamingo Commerce, you can register for training. And that's it, basically. So I hope that you understand now why we did so and what are the benefits that we see here, and hope to got your interest. And if there are any questions, I'm happy to answer. Questions? Yes. There's no official roadmap yet. We are developing actively with it, so we're using it, as I said, in at least 5 teams now. So there will be, you see it also, we moved the complete development of the framework to GitHub, so you see how active it will be there. And definitely there will be new features and stability improvements and whatever, so because we are working with it and we will work for it with it the next years, definitely. But there's no clear roadmap. So if we have new features in the project that we think make sense to be part of Flamingo or Flamingo Commerce, then we develop them as part of the open sourced repositories. And if others start using it, start liking it, and that's the idea. They can contribute back or write own adapters for commerce tools or whatever, and that would be then more community modules. We'll see how it goes. Yeah. Basti, you want to answer that in more detail, maybe? Thank you. That did this answer?
Yeah.
Okay. Other questions? If not, then thanks again. Have a nice good back.